name is Pastor Mark Metz. I'm pastor of Apple Lutheran Church. Just want to thank you all for being here today in the cold. I did try to get everybody a free round of golf after the service, but I was unsuccessful, so I apologize for that. This is the McCory Band and Friends. Is that the right name? Does that work? Okay, excellent. Mac Band. So thank you again for being here. It's a pleasure to worship alongside of you. Let us now take a few moments and prepare our hearts and minds for worship with a musical selection from our band. So to die daily to sin, that we may evermore live with him who died and rose again for us, this we pray, through the same Jesus Christ our Lord, who lives and reigns with you in the Holy Spirit, one God, now and forever. Amen. A reading from the Gospel of John. Now on the first day of the week, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb early, while it was still dark, and saw the stone had been taken away from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken the Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." So Peter went out with the other disciple, and they were going toward the tomb. Both of them were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. And stooping to look in, he saw the linen cloths lying there, but did not go in. Then Simon Peter came following him and went into the tomb. He saw the linen cloths lying there, and the face cloth, which had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen cloths folded up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who had reached the tomb first, also went in and saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture, that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples went back to their homes. But Mary stood, weeping outside the tomb. As she wept, she stooped in to look into the tomb. And she saw two angels in white sitting where the body of Jesus had lain, one at the head and one at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" And she said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Having said this, she turned around and saw Jesus standing, but she did not know that it was Jesus. And Jesus said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping? Whom are you seeking?" Supposing him to be the gardener, she said to him, "Sir, if you have carried him away, tell me where you have laid him, and I will take him away." And Jesus said to her, "Mary." She turned and said to him in Aramaic, "Rabboni," which means teacher. And Jesus said to her, "Do not cling to me, for I have not yet ascended to the Father. But to my brothers, go to my brothers and say to them, I am ascending to my Father and your Father, to my God and your God." Mary Magdalene went and announced to the disciples, "I have seen the Lord," and that he had said these things to her. The word of the Lord, thanks be to God. Please stand and sing along with our opening.
Jesus Christ is risen today. Hallelujah. Our triumphant holy day. Hallelujah. Who did what?
darkness of the grave, blood poured out, a crown of thorns to Christ. Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. From the triumph that is won over the power of fear and death, Christ the Lord is risen today. Walking from the empty tomb, opening wide the gates of life, Christ the Lord is risen today. Lord of life, you defeated death to show that we can rise from all that binds us to the world. Pride, envy, anger, fear, the debt of sin that holds us here, Christ the Lord is risen today. Lord of life, you defeated death to demonstrate a love that is beyond our understanding. It reaches out even to me, saving grace, to all who hear the Christ. Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Lord of life, we pray for all who bring your word of life as light to those in darkness, for those who bring your word of peace to those enslaved by fear, for those who bring your word of love to those in need of comfort. Lord of love, Lord of peace, Lord of resurrection, life be known through our lives and through your power. Christ the Lord is risen today. Hallelujah. Let us pray. Gracious God, let the words of my mouth and the meditations of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Every Wednesday morning after chapel, the president of Trinity School for Ministry, that's my seminary alma mater, he would give talks on ministry and leadership. I remember one occasion when he spoke about conflict. But what surprised me about this lesson is that he suggested that not all conflict was toxic. Some could be good. Conflict could be instructive. He suggested that conflict could actually improve situations or ideas by revealing and then solving the problem. This morning's gospel text that we read from John presents three such conflicts or points of tension which ultimately help us strengthen our faith by identifying potential pitfalls that we could fall into. So there's three such conflicts. The first conflict is between seeing and perceiving. Seeing and perceiving. Right, we read that Peter and John heard that Jesus was not where he was supposed to be, and so they raced to the tomb to find out for themselves. Now, in the following scene, there are two different Greek words for look. Two different words. The first word, when John stoops in to look into the tomb, is blepo. Blepo, meaning to glance at. Quick look, glance. And the second word for look, when John sees again and believes this time, is horao. And that's meaning to perceive. So it's a focus, it's a study, it's a gaze. You see the difference between a glance and a gaze, a focus. G.K. Chesterton, who was a theologian, the forerunner to C.S. Lewis, who inspired C.S. Lewis, once wrote this. He said, the Christian ideal has not been tried and found wanting or lacking. It has been found difficult and left untried. It's been found difficult and left untried. If we were to merely look or glance at Christianity and the gospel, we might find it lacking too. We might find it cumbersome, confusing, restrictive. Yet to Chesterton's point, if we were to gaze upon it, study it, focus on it, we, like John, who perceive the implications of the empty tomb, can also come to believe. Alistair McGrath, who is today a famous Christian writer and theologian, he once viewed God as an infantile illusion, suitable only for the elderly and the intellectually feeble. That's what he said about God. Yet his rigorous quest for truth delivered him to Christianity. His horao-like attention led him to Christ and the gospel. John's perceiving over just merely seeing or glancing is an example for all of us. And not just husbands who glance at the fridge and can't find the milk right in front of their faces, right? My wife's not No matter where we are in our journey, we cannot expect to grow closer to God or increase our faith by offering a blepo, a glance-like attention. We need a hara'o-like attention, a hara'o engagement with the faith. The next conflict is a little less obvious, but it's between staying and retreating. Staying and retreating. Peter and John, as we read, after witnessing the empty tomb, go back home. But Mary stays. She stays. Now, I'm not picking on Peter and John here. They're going back to share the news. John does come to believe, as the writer said. But I do think we can draw out a lesson here. In chapter 8 of John's Gospel, Jesus taught that if you abide in my word, you are truly my disciples. And later he adds, whoever abides in me, and I in him, he it is that bears much fruit. Abiding in Christ is the mark of a true disciple. Abide comes from the Greek meno, which means to stay, right? Remain, reside, not retreat. Stay in it. We can believe like John, but waiting or staying like Mary is the mark of a true disciple, and also the path towards bearing fruit. We cannot receive the full benefits of the gospel if we believe but do not abide in that relationship with Jesus. The parable of the seed in the Synoptic Gospels, or the parable of the sower in the Synoptic Gospels, is a great metaphor for how we receive the gospel. Some of the seed falls on rock, we read in the Gospels, and it sprouts quickly, only to be burnt away by the sun because it lacks good soil. Believing, but not remaining, not abiding, only gives us a veneer of Christianity. It is the seed that falls on rock and does not last long. I want your faith to be deeply rooted, and so does God. The last conflict is most important today, because it's most related to Easter. And that is the conflict between the old way and the new way. Conflict between the old way and the new way. As we know, Mary stays behind and finally comes face to face with the risen Jesus. The text doesn't tell us that Mary wanted to embrace Jesus, but it seems like a reasonable thing for her to do at that time. But before she can extend this natural gesture, Jesus states rather curtly, when we read it, "Do not cling to me. Do not cling to me. I have yet to ascend to my Father." Now, lots of ink has been spilled by commentators trying to make sense of what Jesus is saying. But the consensus seems to be that Jesus is communicating, as one teacher puts it, that the close bond between disciple and teacher cannot be resumed on old terms. The bond between disciple and teacher cannot be resumed on old terms. The resurrection has just occurred. Jesus, who was dead, is now alive. So this reality prompted St. Paul to write that if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. The resurrection affects a whole new era. A new way of understanding reality. A new way of living. A new way of dying. The resurrection marks a transition to a living hope, as St. Peter teaches. Now, the Greeks in the biblical era, where Christianity was developing, was in this Greek-Roman world, they had trouble trusting hope. They didn't want to trust it. One example comes from the poet Sophocles and his work Antigone. Anybody remember reading that in school? Long time ago. Well, one of the characters say something like this: "Wandering hope brings help to many, but others she tricks. Others she tricks." One historian concludes that the relief and comfort of hope is often paired in Greek literature with its unreliability. There was a hesitancy to trust hope, to believe in it, to give into it. So St. Peter, writing after the resurrection, sees nothing unreliable about hope at all. That doubt is all gone. To him, it's not fickle. According to God's great mercy, he writes, He has caused us to be born again to a living hope, active hope, busy hope, not deceptive hope, right? Living, active, busy hope through the resurrection of Jesus Christ. You can argue, perhaps. You can argue that hope is misleading before the resurrection, if you want. But good luck trying after. Out with the old and with the new. There's a legend about Martin Luther. He's the founder of the Lutheran Church, of course, and arguably the Protestant Church. But there's a legend that he once spent 3 days in deep depression, reacting to something that had gone wrong in his life. On the third day, his wife, Katerina von Bora, came downstairs dressed in all black, mourning attire, right? Funeral attire. "Who's dead?" Luther asked. "God," she replied. "What do you mean God is dead? God cannot die," Luther protested. Well, his wife replied, "Then stop acting like he has. Stop acting like he has. The old way is despair, but embracing the new way, means to live trusting that God and the living hope he gives are very much alive." Happy Easter. Thanks be to God. Amen. Please stand for our next song.
We're going to check our tuning real quick. Thank you.
conceived by the power of the Holy Spirit and born of the Virgin Mary. He suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended into hell. On the third day he rose again. He ascended into heaven at the right hand of the Father. He'll come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Catholic Church, the communion of saints, forgiveness of sins, resurrection of the body, and life everlasting. Amen. Let us pray. Almighty God, as you raised Christ from the dead, raise also the hope of peace in our world. Bring an end to warfare, conflict, and violence and threats. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Almighty God, as you raised Christ from the dead, raise also the hope of peace in this nation. Heal divisions, bring reconciliation. Give wisdom and insight to our leaders so they may lead us in truth. Lord, in your mercy. Heavenly Father, as you raised Christ from the dead, raise also the hope of all those who are sick, despairing, sad. Give them the comfort that they need. Lead them and guide them. Bring others into their life. Bring them light into their world. Let light shine in their darkness. Lord, in your mercy, hear our prayer. Heavenly Father, we ask that you remember us in your kingdom and teach us to pray as we say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever.
Please join us in singing, He is Lord.
He is Lord. He is Lord. He is risen from the dead, and He is Lord. Every knee shall
Pastor. Thank you again for being here. Please help yourself to coffee and refreshments. I cannot drink it all, and I cannot eat it all. I will try. Please help yourself to that. Go in peace. Serve the Lord. Thanks be to God.
He is Lord. He is Lord. Christ.